college basketball game in California State University. And although they are often referred to as boys in newspaper articles and the research I've done always refers to them as boys, and I was quite surprised to find out they were actually, their ages range between 24 and 34. So they're not young boys, they're men. The reason why I think they're often referred to as being boys is that they were all considered to be mildly mentally disabled in one way or another, and generally dependent on their respective families. So keep that in mind as we go through this case. The names are, I'll just list the names and their ages, so we know who we're talking about. The first person is Bill Sterling. He was 29 years old. We also have Jack Hewitt, who is 24 years of age. Ted Weir, who was 32 years of age, and Jack Madruga, who was 30 years of age. The fifth person involved was Gary Mathias, who was 25 years of age. So, as I mentioned, all of the five attended the same basketball game on the 24th of February 1978. After the game finished, their team actually won, so they were all happy, and they were ready to head back home. After the game, they stopped by at a local convenience store to pick up some snacks and supplies for the trip home, which would have been roughly 50 miles. None of the five were seen alive after this point. To add to that, all of the five were set to play a Special Olympics tournament. I think it was a week long, yes, a week long, and starting the following day, so February 25th. They were all very excited. One of them actually placed their uniform out the day previously and asked his parents to not let him sleep in. So they had plans for the next day, and I believe the prize for that, for winning the Special Olympics, was a week-long trip to LA, which they were all super excited about. The police were actually called the following day once the families realised that none of the five men made it home. The police were called on February 25th, and the police in both Chico and Yuba City searched along the 50-mile route between the basketball game and their hometown, but found absolutely nothing. A few days later, a ranger at the Plumas National Forest calls the police to say he actually saw the car that the men were said to be travelling in on the day. The car was a 1969 Mercury Montego, and he claimed he saw this on the side of the road in a forest a few days prior. The police follow up on this claim and indeed find the car and confirm that it is the car that the men were known to be travelling in a few days prior. So let's focus on the car. The car was located on a snowy road in the middle of a forest, and this area was not linked in any way to any of the five men that anybody knows of. which is around 30 miles from where the car was found. On March 3rd, she saw some flyers of obviously the missing men and called the police. She claimed she saw four of the men come to the store in a red pickup truck 2 days after the disappearance, so that would have been the 26th of February. And the police also spoke to the store owner, who corroborated the account. Hiked 80 miles all the way home. He, at another point, most widely believed theory is that Matthias had a schizophrenic episode. So, for whatever reason, he was triggered along the 50-mile route home after the basketball game. People believe that Matthias became paranoid and either believed that he was being followed or that the group was in danger. He then, at that point, decided to not follow the route that they were supposed to be on home, but actually go in a different direction, and he subsequently managed to convince the other four that they were also in danger. Now, this would align pretty well with the one sighting reporter that we have of the man who had the heart attack in his car, in that if they were already spooked and they believed they were in danger and being followed, and the car then gets stuck in a snowdrift, they probably panicked and got out. And upon hearing somebody call for help, they probably couldn't see. It was dark. It was the weather. It was winter weather. I imagine that freaked them out. I think if I thought I was being followed and I got stuck in my car, I'd get out and I hear somebody shouting for help. Yeah, that would scare me as well. I imagine that was quite unsettling for them. And that then aligns well with the fact that they didn't approach him. They actually turned the headlights off and went silent. So, at this point, we don't know, did they all make it to the cabin, and then some of them left at different points to look for help or to look for food. We don't know in which order they actually died. It may be that some of them died, as mentioned previously, on the way to the cabin, or it may be that they all made it to the cabin. This does not, however, this theory, none of the theories align with the fact that a store manager and worker saw them 2 days after the disappearance. Again, could they have been in the cabin? But given they broke a window, their families, I was reading some of their families' accounts describing their personalities, and a couple of them certainly were very conscious of not breaking the law and doing things in a particular way. So they didn't have common sense, in the sense that I believe one of them, I can't remember which one right now, but one of them was pulled out of a fire in a separate incident, because he had refused to leave the house as he had to sleep. He had to get his sleep for an important day the following day. So despite the fact that the house was on fire, he refused to leave because he had to get his sleep. So this is what I believe the difficulties are, in that they wouldn't have necessarily acted in a logical manner. And this is why they didn't turn the heating on, they didn't eat any of the food. They ate a couple of cans of the food, but there was food in the cabin to last them a year if they wanted it. And I think that probably aligns with the fact that they maybe thought has a history of trekking and hitchhiking for miles and miles and miles on end. He has done it before. It wouldn't be wildly out there to think that he's done it again, or he tried to do that again, and for whatever reason, maybe the weather just was just too bad. He succumbed to exposure himself, but perhaps a lot further away than the others, and he was just never discovered. I think that's the most likely scenario. I mean, this was in the 70s, so chances of him turning up now are probably very, very, very slim. And it is more than likely that he also didn't make it and was just not found. I don't believe that there were a couple of Reddit threads discussing how Matthias might have actually orchestrated and premeditated this. I just don't see that. He did suffer from paranoid schizophrenia, but he wasn't, and he had been violent previously, but there were no signs.